Actually, I have a sticky note that I usually put up on my screen, but it was lying on my desk. Okay, thank you. Remember that next week I will not be here. If things continue as they are, we are planning to go for a week at a private house, and so we'll be safe. But Miss Nancy is graciously going to cover for me, and I'm looking forward to it. In fact, if Beach doesn't call me, I'm probably going to tune in to just listen to her. So she's got a wonderful, wonderful message she wants to share with you that she's been working on. So Nancy, thank you again so much for your willingness to do that. I really appreciate it. And if you've not been had the pleasure of hearing Nancy before, you've got a real treat in store, so don't miss it. But yes, Marie.
Yeah, unmute.
Okay. Do we study the regular lesson, or Nancy, do we not?
No. Oh, no, just that I'm moving the regular lesson forward. She's going to cover a different thing, but it's interesting how God uses people and uses circumstances, because what she's going to be talking about is just right in tune with the lessons that we've been going along with for the last 2 or 3 weeks, and we'll go a little bit farther in the next week or two. So, but yeah, I hope all of you got the extended schedule that I sent out. If you didn't, please let me know. I'll send it to you again.
And I'll be sending out the links again for this meeting, because I'll have to start them from my computer. And it will have some scripture reading from it in Genesis. We're going to be looking a little bit more at Sarah. And after I told Gary I was going to do a little bit of a character study with Sarah, Kent preached about her that Sunday, and I didn't know that. So I'm going to go refer back to his message and kind of pick up from there.
Good. If you look on that schedule, her scripture reference is included there, so you can find it, and that'll help you if you need to do some preparation, which I hope you do.
Nancy, could you give me a call with those numbers? I don't do all that, and I don't ever get those numbers, so if you'll give me a phone call.
I'll be glad to.
Thank you.
All right. The title of the lesson today is Wonderful, from rivalry to reconciliation. And it really gives us, I think, a wonderful, wonderful image of God. And it's an image of God that sometimes we sort of segment. We look at the image of God from the Old Testament. We look at the image of God that we see in the New Testament. But when we sort of begin to combine them, as we do in the scriptures that we have for the lesson today, we find that God's the same across the lines. It makes absolutely no difference. His image remains one of love, of grace, of caring, and compassion. And the beautiful part of God's relationship is with his people are the ways in which we see God of grace, God of compassion, God of love being imaged in the faces of us, his children, his people, and the way in which we share and care for each other, the way in which we assume responsibility for each other, is a part of what we understand as being the character of God. And we see that in each of the four different scripture references that we look at today. We're going to be looking at some of the most interesting characters that I think I've ever encountered in the Bible, and particularly in the Old Testament. And their stories that accompany those characters are stories that if I called on one of you and asked you to tell me, for example, about Ishmael and Isaac, you could probably do it pretty easily and probably come very close to quoting the scripture exactly. They're familiar to us. And what we have to do is draw upon that familiarity and that understanding of those stories to help us to better be engaged and ready to do what God calls us to do. And what he calls us to do is to imitate the gracious heart of God, as McLaren puts it. Jacob and Esau, wonderful story. We know all about it. Jacob and Esau were the twin grandsons of Abraham. And recall that they engaged in bitter rivalries all of their lives because of the conniving way in which Jacob was able to basically take away the birthright from Esau, who was the firstborn and was entitled to that birthright, which means he inherited all the property. And so over the years, both of those men went their separate ways, and that bitter rivalry sort of went with them. But with age and with wisdom, we so often see in cases of human nature that that sense of hatred, of bitterness, of rivalry sort of ebbs a little bit. And we find that people become a little bit more understanding, I guess is one way to put it, in terms of relationships and these kinds of things. And that was the truth here with these two twin brothers. And we know the story that Jacob is on his way back home, and the purpose of his going back home is basically to claim that birthright. And along the way, he begins to be very, very concerned because he understands that Esau is coming out to meet him, and he's not coming by himself. He's bringing 400 soldiers with him. So Jacob has every right to be just a little bit concerned because he thinks his brother has probably carried that bitterness and that sense of betrayal, if you will, with him all these years. And so as that time of meeting draws very close, Jacob finds himself conflicted in such a way that he literally cannot sleep. And this figure comes and wrestles with him. And the scriptures give us the understanding that it's an angel, or it could literally be God himself with whom Jacob wrestles. Whatever the figure or the personage was, it's no doubt whatsoever that spirit of God, of an angel, or whatever it was, what moved in such a way with him that through that wrestling, he became a changed person. He wasn't able to completely lay aside all of his fears. But coming out of that, he had to face a struggle, and in facing that struggle, what he literally did was have to face himself. And so many times when we find ourselves in situations where we're having difficulty reconciling with someone in our life, we first have to come to an understanding of who we are and where we figure into that rivalry. And see what maybe we can do and what maybe we have done to actually fuel that rivalry, and in this case, over a number of years. And so they meet out with each other, and Jacob limps out to meet Esau, and he has his whole family and all of his retinue lined up behind him. He falls down and kneels before his brother, and then Esau does one of the most beautiful things that I think a human being can ever, ever, ever do. He runs to his brother, grabs him up in a huge hug, kisses his cheek, and they both begin to shed tears, I'm sure. And that sense of moving from revenge to reconciliation clearly indicated that both of these men have changed. And that change has been initiated largely by God in the way in which they have allowed God to lead them to this point of coming together. And in the scripture, there's one little statement in there that I think is absolutely beautiful, and somehow or other it never really resonated with me in past years when I've looked at it. Jacob himself went on ahead and bowed down to the ground 7 times as he approached his brother. But Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him. He threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. And then Jacob had also sort of played all of the cards he could, and he had prepared and sent forward a number of very, very valuable at that time gifts to Esau to help solve or perhaps resolve part of the problems that they had had. And so Esau refused to accept the gifts. He said, "Our coming together and reconciling is all the gift I need." I'm paraphrasing there. But Jacob looks at him and says, "If I find favor with you, then accept my present from my hand." Now here comes the statement that I mentioned. "For truly to see your face is like seeing the face of God." Isn't that beautiful? That's one of those statements that just sort of grabs at your heart, because here is this man who lost sleep, who has probably anguished over the bitter, bitter rivalry, all of the missed opportunities to be connected with his brother. And now all of a sudden, God has brought them together. And his reaction is one in which he actually sees God in the face of his brother. He had to have been a changed man. And in fact, I suspect that both of them were forever and eternally changed as a result of what they had, both had to go through to come to this point of reconciliation. Then we turn to Joseph and his brothers. You know that story too. The interesting thing here with this one is there are some themes of similarity that run between the two. We know that the brothers sold him into slavery because he was the young kid who was the favorite of the father. And they had taken all of the abuse that they could take because Joseph was, even as a young kid, was evidently pretty good at taking advantage of his position within the family. That's a kind way of saying he took advantage of the fact that his father thought he was the best of the bunch. They sold him into slavery. Donnie and I wanted to sell Dan also, but our parents would never let us do it. He was 8 years younger. But in any event, in this case, they sold him, but it turned out to be the best thing that had ever happened, not just to Joseph, but to a multitude of people then and then continuing on into the future. You know that Joseph was sold into Potiphar, and then he moved on up within the Pharaoh's court. He eventually was, Potiphar's wife tried to seduce him. She claimed rape. He was put in jail. He got out of jail because he could read dreams and he became close to some servants of the Pharaoh. Then he ultimately became what would be considered, I think, in many ways, prime minister of Egypt. So he went from slave to one of the top officials within Pharaoh's court. Jacob sent his brothers to Egypt because there was a famine and he knew Egypt had some food. So he sent them to try to find anything they could to bring back to preserve the family and keep them from starving. And in the course of that, they came into contact with Joseph, whom they did not recognize at first. And then when we see Joseph finally revealing himself, he weeps bitter tears at this coming together with his brothers. "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God?" He says that because the brothers are scared to death that given his power and his position in Pharaoh's court, he can call out a dozen soldiers and kill them in a heartbeat, or they could be placed in prison for the rest of their lives, just on his word. And so he looks at them and he said, "I'm not acting as a God here. You intended to harm me, but God intended for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children reconciliation, forgiving, accepting, wanting to come together and show out of a very intense, burning love for his family, for his brothers." He's moved to make this kind of decision. The brothers go back home. They tell Jacob about what has happened, and they bring him to Egypt with him. He's reunited with them and stays there until his death. When they come back eventually to Egypt, the brothers are still a little bit concerned because Jacob had sent a message through the brothers to Joseph saying, "Don't harm the brothers." And so they were still afraid, well, Dad's gone, so that no longer holds, and so Joseph can do whatever he wants to. And so they were rightfully, again, very, very concerned. But Joseph welcomed them, Joseph forgave them, Joseph embraced them, and nothing changed in terms of his relationship with them, except that love had intensified. And again, I think those brothers saw the image of God in the face of Joseph as he did this. McLaren wrote about all of this when he said, "He imitated the gracious heart of God." Joseph, here's who he's talking about. And so rather than trying to do exactly what the brothers had done, which was do away with him, he took just the opposite He imaged God in showing kindness to them. Blessing, power, or favor is not given for privilege over others, but for service, for the benefit of others. So those are two of several stories, and you know many of them. So let's take the leap then to where does Jesus come into this same thing that we're looking at here of reconciliation, and through reconciliation, seeing the face, the image of God? We've got several stories, but there are two in particular that sort of rise to the top, if you will, when we start thinking about those. The first one is the parable of the Good Samaritan. You know the story. The priest and the Levi walk by this man who has been set upon by robbers, beaten almost to death, literally thrown into a ditch by the side of the road. A priest and a Levi walk by and they glance at him and then keep on moving. And then finally, one of the people from a group of people who were literally shunned by the Jews, a Samaritan, stops and sees the man, doesn't know who he is. There's some conjecture that perhaps that man was Jewish himself. And not thinking about who he was, where he came from, what is his pedigree or anything else, what he saw was a wounded man who was in desperate need of help or he was going to die. The Samaritan picked him up, put him on his donkey, took him to an inn, paid the innkeeper, helped pay for the medicines to take care of his wounds and injuries, and then paid a down payment on anything else. As he said, I'll be coming back through and I'll pick up the charges for anything else that goes beyond this sum of money. The difference between the Levite and the other one who saw this Samaritan and did nothing was that they looked, but they did not see. In the case of the Samaritan not only looked, but he also saw. You know, in this day and age, we have people who have so many needs, and there's no way that we're going to be able to minister to everybody. It's just simply physically impossible to do that. But we do have to see. We can just look and shake our heads. We can lift these people up in prayers, certainly, and that's important. We can give money that can be put into community services or missions or any number of different kinds of things, and that's also wonderful. But that's remote kindness. That's remote care. That's extended kinds of ways in which we get involved. And those are opportunities, I think, that are lost for us to image the face of God as we deal with those people who are so desperately in need. I'm reminded of a statement from Edward Everett Hale. It's one of those that I've said so many times, it's sort of like a paperclip. I wish I had done that. And when he wrote, it's been modified a little bit, but I like his original words. I am only one, but I still am one. I cannot do everything. But still, I can do something. Because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something I can do. That was the Samaritan. And he did everything that he could, that it was possible for him to do, not thinking about repercussions from it, but thinking about only he saw this man in desperate need. And that Samaritan, not the Levite, not the priest, that Samaritan imaged the face of God. There's a story of Francis of Assisi, who was walking down the road, and I don't know if this is true or not, but it's a beautiful story one way or the other. He's walking down a road and he encounters a leper, and he is so filled with compassion for this leper that he leans down and puts his hands on him, speaks to him, and tries to encourage him. And then he bends down and kisses the cheeks of a leper. And then as he turns to leave, he looks back and the leper's gone. And so Francis of Assisi thought in his heart, he said, I think I've just kissed the face of Christ. And that brings us to one of the last sections we want to look at here in this lesson today. we're going to skip over the prodigal son because it's so very similar to the case of Esau, I think. But Jesus is teaching, some say it's a parable. I think it's more of a teaching than it is a parable. Teaching the disciples, and he gets into the story about the sheep and the goats, you know, where he says, come on my right hand, on my left hand, and when did we do this? And he says, for I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. And then those on the right hand, the sheep, I think that's right, the sheep, representing the sheep, said, well, Lord, that's wonderful, but when did we do that? And he said, basically, when you've done this to the least one of these, you've done it unto me. Think of Francis of Assisi again. Here's one who was unclean, an unclean person. When Francis of Assisi kneeled down, comforted him, kissed him on the cheek. Love your neighbor, even if he plays a trombone. I was a trombone player, so I love that one. That's an old Yiddish tale. You could also say, love your neighbor, even if he plays a bagpipe. I think that's worse than a trombone. But in any event, we're not to be choosy about who our neighbors are. We're not to be choosy about who it is that we have relationships with. We don't have the right to decide who is going to gain our love, who is going to gain our compassion. Because they are people of God who are created in the image of God, just like we are. What we're to do is to image the face of God in our relationships with them. We're going to always have people who are having difficult times. I'm not going to say we'll always have the poor with us, but they're going to be people who are going to be experiencing all manner of different kinds of difficulties. We're not equipped to deal with all of them in terms of our skill sets or maybe the resources that we have to bear to bring to share with those who are so desperately in need, but we can do something. And we have to look, but more than in looking, we also have to see. And when we see, we can't just say, oh, shame, that's such a pity. We need to do something. Even if it's calling somebody who's better equipped to take care of this person. Even if it's carrying quarters, so as you drive by a laundromat, if on the chance you see some people in there, you go and share with them. There's a great story about a pastor of a church, a Lutheran church in North Dakota. One Sunday morning, the church members are coming to church and they see this dirty, filthy, bearded man, stinky, smelly guy sitting on the front steps of the church. And many of them find a way to go way around him to go in the front door. And finally, this one lady has compassion on the man and brings him a cup of coffee. And all the church members are seated in the sanctuary, waiting for the service to start, waiting for the pastor to come to the pulpit. And all of a sudden, they look up and they see this man walking down the aisle. He goes right up to the proscenium, stands behind the pulpit, takes off his nasty hat, pulls off his fake beard, and it's their pastor. It's their pastor. And he says this to them. I didn't do this to embarrass you or to poke you in the eye. I did it to remind us that this is a person that Jesus loves, and he has called us to love him too. He has called us to love him too. So how do we get from rivalry and reconciliation to these kinds of understandings? I think rivalries are prompted by some of the same emotions that lead us not to be compassionate about other people. We see ourselves in a different position from those who probably are in most need of what we have to offer to help them. And so somehow or other, we have to reconcile our own biases, our own prejudices in some cases, as was in the case of the Samaritan, and do the bigger chore, do the right thing, take the high road is another way we would put it, and do what God would have us to do what literally God has called us to do. And we can't solve all of the problems of the world. We cannot bring peace between people, but we can begin to chip away at it as individuals and as a church. McLaren closes the chapter with this. He says, if we want to reflect the image of God, we will choose grace over hostility, reconciliation over revenge, and equality over rivalry. When we make that choice, we encounter God in the faces of our former rivals and enemies. And as we are humbled, surrendering to God and seeking to be reconciled with others, our faces too reflect the face of God. We come alive as God's image bearers indeed. And I think that is so, so, so very true. So if you have not had time to read the scriptures that are listed for this lesson today, I plan to go back and read them again, even though I've spent, I don't know, several hours with them over the last 2 weeks preparing this lesson. But every time we read those, we find something that will encourage us, that will energize us, that will motivate us to literally be those who serve as and provide the image of God, who become the face of God, if you will, in our community, in our world. And again, we can't do it all. We can't do it all. Julia Carney was a poet, lady who wrote in the mid part of the 19th century. She wrote this cute little poem, and I think it's so very fitting and a good way to close. Little drops of water and little grains of sand make the mighty ocean and the beauteous land. And the little moments, humble though they may be, make the mighty ages of eternity. Little deeds of kindness, little words of love, make our earth an Eden like heaven above. Can't beat that. Amen. Love you all. You all have a great week. Nancy, thank you again for your willingness to help out next week. And like I say, if I can, you may see my face, you may not, because it may not be pretty. But in any event, I hope you all do stay safe. Stay together, help each other, support each other. Bye. Let's go to church.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, Nancy.
See you, Donna. Tell old what's his name I said hey. Hey, Miss Marianne, I haven't spoken to you this morning.
Hey, good morning. I was a little late getting on. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I see John's watch, so I see he's there with
you. Yeah, he's there too.
Hey, Bob Gibson, how are you?
I'm all right. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can. Have you got Miss Aurelia there with you?
Not at the second, right at this moment. She just stepped away.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. You doing okay, Bob?
She's doing pretty good.
Good. Yeah. How's Jackson doing?
Jackson's doing great.
Oh, wonderful.
We're just so pleased with the good news about him. You know, we just rejoice in every day over that.
So. Oh, you betcha.
Yeah.
That was a scary thing, wasn't it?
It was absolutely unbelievable.